Give it up for John and Fairlight. Woo-hoo! All right, I have one question for you. Are you awake?
Yes.
You are now, aren't you? Right on. Oh, my heart is filled with gratitude for all of us being right here present in this very moment, gifting ourselves with that beautiful vulnerability of allowing the truth to just bubble up and spill forth and be our song, be our dance this morning. What a privilege, what a gift, and what an inherent responsibility. Yeah. March. Didn't the Beyond Limits graduates do an exceptional job last week being brave? Yes, they did. Yes, they did. That song reminds me of exactly what unfolded and birthed here last Sunday. It was big and it was fabulous and miraculous and courageous and brave. And we're continuing to ride on that wind. We're continuing to open our sails even more and catch that wind of truth and vulnerability being revealed through us. Absolutely. So what are we here for this morning? You know, our topic this month is all about spiritual living through lifelong learning and expanding our consciousness, expanding our ability to recognize that we are not stagnant, we are not fixed, and we are not an island. And so all of that kind of comes together, and we're going to explore it greatly this morning. To start off with, it's all about truth and authenticity. As Dr. Yvonne mentioned, one of our readings, selected readings, books for the month is Brené Brown's Daring Greatly. And I know we have spoken of that particular book here in the past, but today, you know, we're diving in even greater because we're tying it into that responsibility and privilege we all have to continue to expand the truth of who we are and what we know and to make a difference in the world because we're doing that. It's really powerful. The nature of truth and authenticity is a force that will always rise to the top. It's like cream, okay? The nature of truth and authenticity is a force that will always rise to the top. This truth is exhibited in the natural and spiritual world. It becomes our task to strive to be this truth within our human life. Full moon today, who's feeling it?
Yeah.
Right. Who's feeling the full moon today? So this is, as they all are, this is a very special full moon. This one, this beautiful grandmother moon is calling us to recalibrate and restore as we rise into our real work, just like the cream, okay? That's the power of this full moon, to recalibrate and restore as we rise to our real work. It is a great potential right now for heart opening and spiritual growth. And what is the thing, what is one of those things that just really tends to open our heart? Anybody? Yeah, chocolate usually comes after, but well, what are some of the things that tend to really open our heart?
Music.
Okay, music, yes. Yes, and struggle and strife, right? That thing that we find when we're walking that journey and path of life that causes us to stop, and after we get over the initial how we think and feel about it, we reach deep into our soul and we pull out our courage and our vulnerability because we know that we are not that thing that we have found in the journey and the path of our life. We are so much more than that. Yet there's a reason for it. We're being opened, we're being expanded. And then some of the readings on the full moon today go on to say that with the planet Chiron and Mercury also very close to the sun at this point in time, each of us has an enhanced capacity to heal, especially using the tools that we have learned. So do you see where we're going here? We're rising to the top just like cream, because we're going to give ourselves permission to be vulnerable and to have the courage to be vulnerable in the midst of whatever it is that we may be going through right now and facing, because we all know full moon really brings it out in us, doesn't it? At least some of us. It really does. And so we have this enhanced power and energy and capacity to heal. I believe we do all the time, but shoot, why not ride on the coattails of this powerful lunation, right? So let's take that into our conscious awareness. So it says these activities supported by the diligent Virgo moon will help us forgive and release the limiting thoughts and misconceptions that have inhibited our access to cosmic wisdom. Isn't that kind of the go of it? We always talk about the spiral. And when we come back around again on the spiral, we're in a different place. We're always in a different place because we're expanding. But how much of that wisdom can we embody? How much? Anybody? How much can we embody? As much as we believe. As much as we allow. As much as we give ourselves permission to. As much as we say yes, claim our truth, and then put forth that courage and vulnerability to walk through it, to literally walk through it and come out on the other side. So it goes on to say, there's tension afoot. We're being pushed to change. We are right in the midst of dissolving and creating. Dissolving, creating. Aren't we always in the midst of dissolving and creating? Because we have that beautiful, ultimate power of getting to choose what within us we want to dissolve and what within us we want to create. So we're waking up to the healing of our minds, and we're waking up to the programs that continuously run in the background. Those programs, we get to wake up to them and decide, do they serve us or not? Then we get to dissolve and create based on that. So Ernest Holmes says our whole spiritual evolution is but a process of awakening to that which was there and real before we perceived it. Okay? We're awakening to that which was real before we perceived it. What is the truth that we know about ourselves? Anybody? What is the truth that we know about who and what we are and whose and what we are? What is it? Anybody? Divine expressions. That's the truth about you, isn't it, Cindy? You are a divine expression revealing itself in the most beautiful, unique, sanctified way that you can, right? And it's brilliant, and it's gorgeous, and it's hairy, and it's scary, and it's frightening, and it's joyful, and it's exhilarating, and it's delicious. You guys following me on this? Yeah, holy cow. So let's go to the first of my slides. Don't know. Oh, there we go. Look at that. So this is what we are all about this Sunday service. How many of you have been there? Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's one of the greatest teachers, isn't it? When we saw off the exact limb that we happen to be sitting on, that is a picture of visualization of self-sabotage, which is what Brené is teaching about. How do we truly move from this limited way of living and viewing and believing about ourselves that constantly has us showing up in life, self-sabotaging ourselves, cutting off our own limb? So I know what it takes. It takes courage and vulnerability to express the divine that resides at the very core of our being as our truth. So we're going to dive into that this morning. Next slide. And there's a reason for that. The road to success is always under construction. Okay? It's always under construction. So if you're one that gets really put out with things being under construction, I'm going to invite you to take on a different belief about that. Because it's not going away. As long as we're breathing air into our lungs, we are evolving. Whether you like it or not, kicking and screaming, you can keep cutting off the limb that you're sitting on, but you will evolve. You might fall harder and harder and harder, I don't know, but it will take place. Expansion and evolution will take place. So just know that, and the reason why it's important to know that is so that we can be at peace with it. oh, the road to success is always under construction. Okay, I'm good with that. You get to decide how you want to construct that, though. We are on the path of experience, just waking to the real fact of our true being. As we awake, we find we are surrounded by many false conditions. Remember I said that the lunation is also bringing to mind that automatic reel that's constantly running in the background of your mind? That's what we're talking about here. But there is something within which remembers the real state. If one will sit in quiet contemplation of good as an inner experience, they will experience the good which you contemplate. You can do this only as you turn from that which is evil and dwells on God alone. The universe will not be divided. That's a quote from Ernest Holmes, and as you can see, he always writes in the he vernacular, and I try to put in you or it or to kind of follow up on that. But that quote is really powerful, and we've talked about this over and over and over again, so I'm not going to belabor the point. But the whole idea, first principle of our teaching, is unity. It's oneness. And when we step outside of that idea of oneness into a belief of separation, like sawing off the log that we happen to be sitting on, the limb that we happen to be sitting on, that's a belief in separation. It creates pain. It creates strife, a tumultuous life. I don't know about you, but I'm kind of done with pain and strife and a tumultuous life. I can't even say it, so I'm so done with it. It's not even in my vocabulary anymore. Woo! So let's go to the next slide, please. Ernest Holmes, love this. Accepting the lessons and experiences of the past and taking the best from everything, we should press boldly forward, looking ever for the truth and ever ascending higher and higher into the heavens of reality. Do you all know what he's talking about there? It's kind of like my talk title for the day. That constant ascension, if we are courageous enough to look at our life as if every single bit, speck, dust, piece was truly a gift for us to realize and reveal even more of our divine expression that is unique only to us. Do you see how that energetic vibration might change, might feel differently than if we were to maybe continually cut off the tree limb that we're sitting on and then get angry about it and blame the world and blame everybody else and never be courageous enough and vulnerable enough to go within and say, what's this all about? What am I doing here? What am I creating? Why do I keep cutting off the tree limb that I'm sitting on? Is it because I'm addicted to pain? Is it because I'm addicted to emotional disturbances? You know, addictions are tricky. Just like in that great movie, What the Bleep, I love the visual, where the receptor sites of the cells, you know, we train ourselves to have their own receptor sites where they call out for that one thing to lock in. And we can change that. We have the power to change that. We are not victims of our addictions. We are not victims of the drama that we create every time we cut off the limb of the tree. We don't have to be anymore. As soon as we evolve and wake up, use courage to be vulnerable and look inside, are you following me here? Then we can really look at it. So there's a lot to be said for confession. There's a lot to be said for that. There's a lot to be said for in the 12 steps, where the step looks at, how does it go? Where you look at all of your, you do an inventory, you look at all of your, I don't know what they call them, transgressions, and you own up for your part in it. Or even the Jewish faith in Judaism, Yom Kippur. You know, there's something to be said to actually have the courage to be vulnerable, to look within ourselves and say, okay, what is up with me? What is driving this? Because it doesn't feel so good, and I would really like to change it. I'd really like to evolve. And I tell you what, vulnerability is not a sign of weakness. It's a sign of wisdom. It's a sign of courage. It's a sign of evolved essence of divine expression. So let's go to the next slide, please. Don't let the pride of what you know keep you from receiving what you have yet to perceive. We are launching all of our classes for next semester, and you guys got a taste of how powerful our classes are in regards to transforming lives and creating a world that works for everyone from our service last Sunday. But just think, can you relate to that at all? I can. I can remember times where I was so proud of what I knew, I couldn't open my mind to take in a different, brand new, fresh perspective that my whole heart and body and soul was calling out for. What's up with that? That's another sawing of the log, by the way. That's another self-sabotage. So I am inviting us, me and you and everyone in this world, to let go of our pride of what we think we know. Because there's always an unlimited pool of knowledge and wisdom and experience that we get to pull from. And most of it's right here within you. That's where the beauty of the vulnerability of going within comes from. The thing that I have printed in the bulletin every single Sunday, the answer to the prayer is in the prayer. You already have all the answers that you have ever sought right there within you. And not within the little I, the little M for me, or the little Y for you. It's in the big one. The big one. The big one is the one I'm talking about that's connected to source. The big one that knows the truth of your being. The big one that is your intuition. The big one that is when you go within and really ask the question of whatever it is that you are desiring greater clarity on, greater strength on, greater guidance on, and it always comes. Where does that come from? Anybody? Where does it come from? I do this to make sure you guys are listening, right? Where does it come from? That guidance, that intuitive nudge, that wisdom that comes from within us, where does it come from? It comes from source. So does that mean source is within you? Oh my God. Oh no, it's your God. Oh no, it's my God. No, it's everybody's God. Yes, source is within you. Absolutely. And it goes back to that first principle of oneness and unification, or a sense of separation. Go there with me, folks. I know you know what I'm talking about. Those times when you look outside of yourself for the answers, when you're pleading, when you're hurting, when you're feeling like there's no answer, or when you're blocked, or when you feel like you're pushed against a wall, when you're in turmoil and you're looking outside for the answers, how does that go? Does that end well? No, it really doesn't. What about when you go within, when you connect to that truth that's within you? And it takes vulnerability to do that sometimes. Because sometimes we don't want to notice or recognize what's in there. We want to turn our head and say, no, that's not in me. I can't possibly be judgmental. Or I can't possibly think that way about myself or somebody else. But you know what, folks? The only way out is through. We have got to go through those thoughts. We have got to go through those false beliefs in order to dissolve them. It's the truth. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about why. Oh, everybody take a nice long deep breath. You know, when I do that, that means I need one. Yes. So, the whole purpose of the science of mind is to reconcile the apparent separation of the spiritual world with the material world. So the spiritual world must be perfect, and the material world appears imperfect. The spiritual world is the cause of the material world. You see, it comes before. We are spiritual beings governed by mental law. Only that world can appear to us which we mentally perceive. Man's experience is the logical outcome of his inner vision. His horizon is limited to the confines of his own consciousness. Whenever this consciousness lacks a true perspective, its outward expression will lack harmony. That is why we are taught to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Since no one lives by proxy, although we try, right? Do you get what that means? Since no one lives by proxy, like you can mail in your ballot, you don't have to be present and vote on it yourself. You can just mail it in and say, they know what I mean. Yeah, that doesn't work really well in your life either. Oh, life knows what I mean. No, it really is beneficial to stop, breathe, get clear, go within, and get that intuitive guidance that is always right. And so, back to the proxy thing. Since no one lives by proxy, but each unto himself, each individual must make the test of his own soul. And that's the other beauty of it. We make up our own test. So if you are feeling like the test is hard, and you don't have the answers, and you don't know where to go to get the answers, check in with the test maker. That would be you. How many times did you want to do that when you were in school, right? Make up your own test. Well, you know what? It has been done, and the students make up a far harder test than the instructor would ever do. Do you see how we are with ourselves? We can be pretty darn hard with ourselves. Thomas Troward says this, "We have never been out of our right path, only we have been walking in it backwards instead of forwards." Could you imagine walking your path backwards? And now that we have begun to follow the path in the right direction, right, meaning forward, not because I don't believe in a right and wrong, meaning forward, we find that it is none other than the way of peace, the path of joy, the road to eternal life. These things we may attain by simply living naturally within ourselves. It is because we are trying to be or to do something which is not natural to us that we experience weariness and labor. Where we should find all of our activities joyously concentrated by the force of the love that we have for them. But when we make the grand discovery of how to live naturally, we shall find it to be all and more than all, a perpetual joy to ourselves, and we shall radiate light and life wherever we go. Does that sound like a pretty good goal? You know people like that already? I do. Most of you are in this room right now. I mean, honestly, you guys really rock. Big time. So Brené Brown's book, Daring Greatly. Brené says, owning our story and loving ourselves through that process is the bravest thing that we will ever do. Do you believe that? Think about the bravest thing that you could ever do. And it could be different than what I just said. Just think about something brave that you could ever do. I can think of some things. I helped my best friend deliver both of her children at home. That was pretty brave. I mean, not for me, for her. Without the epidural, you know what I mean? That was pretty brave. So you think about the bravest thing you could ever do. Now I want you to listen to these words. Now think about your life and truly owning your whole story and loving yourself through the every single character and action. Loving yourself truly and authentically, not judging yourself, not criticizing yourself, not saying, oh, if I had done it this way, not correcting yourself, but owning every part of you and loving every part of you. Brené says that's the bravest thing that you could ever do, to tell the truth about who and what you are. And I would add that spiritually, this means to be able to tell who we are in terms of our relative human nature, as well as grasp and revere in our absolute divine nature. The telling of our story is an ongoing one of reconciliation of these two parts. So Brené says you better be able to tell the truth about who you are and where you come from, and what you're up against, and like yourself in the process of telling that truth, because our sense of worthiness lives inside our story. How is your sense of worthiness today? Where are you? And you don't have to answer this. I'm just asking for you to bring it up. Where are you on that scale of worthiness today for yourself? Because wherever you are on that scale, Brené says, you got to be able to tell the truth about who you are and where you've come from and what you're up against, because your sense of worthiness is linked to that. The challenge is to live our truth that is true and not a script that we've been given. And I'll give you some examples of that. Like good little boys and girls behave this way. That's a script. That's a measurement device that I don't think is working really well with our young ones today. Because who says behaving whatever way is the right way for them? I don't know. Success equates to money, title, and achievements. It might be partially true, but I don't buy into that completely. Well-behaved means to censor certain feelings. Do you all believe that? As much as I can, I try to catch myself in censoring my feelings. Well, especially up here. Because, you know, there's just a fine line with what you can say, what you can't say from up here. And sometimes I tread lightly over that line. But when you catch yourself censoring, yeah, I'm getting a lot of feedback. Can we turn that down just a little bit? Thanks. So when you censor your feelings, what do you think happens inside? You know, if you're censoring how you really feel, man, that's like, have you ever cooked with a pressure cooker? That's like cooking with a pressure cooker on high and never letting the steam valve open, you know? When you censor some of your feelings, it's like the beautiful song that John and Fairlight did, you know? You gotta say what you wanna say. You gotta let that stuff out. Being in the moment. You gotta let it flow. Let it go through you. Crisis of faith is unacceptable because one should have a constant knowing and a steady stream of manifestation. Boy, that just sounds horrible to even read. Yeah, wow. Ugh. Yeah, it makes me want to butt. Right? I mean, geez Louise, talk about somebody being kind of high on their high post there to actually say something like that. I have a crisis of faith almost every day. What about you guys? You know? What a great opportunity for me to get even more clear on who I am and whose I am. Illness is weakness. You guys ever heard that one? I don't believe that. I believe illness is one of our greatest teachers. So out of all these that I've read, are there any that you resonated with? Any that you were told? Or any others that you could add to the pile? Anybody? Anybody have one you want to add? So what does it feel like when your life does not match the story you were told you should have? What does it feel like? Does it make you feel like a failure? Maybe like you're not measuring up? Maybe like you're not worthy? You give your power away. Yes, you do. So who are you afraid of disappointing? That's something that I ask a lot when I'm working with people that are so stuck in the judgment of themselves that they can't tell that they're judging themselves. So I say, what's your measurement device? Which kind of ruler did you create to measure how you are, what do you call that? How you're measuring up against whatever it is that you're criticizing yourself for? And this is another good question. Who are you afraid of disappointing? It's a good question, because usually when I'm asked that, I say my mother, right? I mean, you know, disappointing mom is a big deal. Oh, but you know, by the time we get to be the age that we are, of all of us in this room, disappointing our mother probably needs to not be in our subconscious, ruling everything that we do and say. Just saying. Or who are you afraid of disappointing? Yourself? Who will hold the space for your full story? And the reason why I ask that, because Brené talks about shame. Without an awareness of our inherent wholeness and without the guidance and skill to see ourselves compassionately, we become mired in shame. And shame, my friends, is way down on the consciousness, vibrational, energetic frequency. Way down there. Shame's universal tapes are not good enough, never good enough, and who do you think you are? That doesn't feel very empowering, does it? No. There are three universal truths about shame that Brené talks about. We all have it, we're afraid to talk about it, and the less we talk about it, the more we have it. Catch 22 situation there. Talk about sawing off the limb that we're sitting on. That's a big one. Shame. So it's time to talk about it. We all have it. Would you agree? And we're afraid to talk about it. Kind of moving out of that. Kind of important to start talking about it. And the less we talk about it, the more we have. So there's this thing that happens where shame cannot live. It cannot breathe air and have oxygen and continue to have a life. And that's when we move into authenticity. That's when we own who we are. And we do that by becoming vulnerable. And again, like I said, vulnerability is not a weakness. Not at all. Ooh, so I'm gonna share some stuff here. One of the teens who is now in her mid-20s, one of the first teens I ever took through camps and worked with and had the pleasure of watching her grow up into this beautiful, amazing, powerful, strong woman that she is. She wrote something just the other day that caught my eye. Her name is Haley, and she now lives in New York City. Her dream growing up was to go to a culinary school and to become a chef in New York City, and she has accomplished that dream. So I want to read what she says here. Immediately after the election, I shared a story on Facebook about a traumatic experience I had as a young queer person that felt relevant to the conversation about conversion therapy today. That story was reshared thousands of times, and this winter I was asked if I'd be willing to share that story in front of a very large audience with a microphone. I said yes. I've been developing this story for about a month now, and to be honest, it's been really uncomfortable to trudge through it all again. Life is pretty sweet for me these days. I have a hot fiance, I have a little black pug dog, a sweet job, and I live in my favorite city in the whole wide world. Why would I want to go on stage and talk about the shittiest thing that's ever happened to me in front of a national audience? Because if there was any way that I can prevent one single queer kid from going through the experience that I had by sharing my story, then I will. She says, talk is easy, action is a lot harder. My job is to remember that I don't reveal my values by what I say. I reveal them by how I live. It doesn't matter what others are doing. It matters what I'm doing. Am I living my values? Are you living your values? And if so, good. And if not, I stop, I take a breath, and I start again because my life is my message, even when it's hard, and I want to stick with the values that I hold dear. So I'm going to share her story with you. It's not long. But it's really powerful. And I know that we all have life stories, that we are meant to be vulnerable and courageous enough to live our story. There's so much healing and liberation and freedom that comes from that, and it dissolves and heals shame. It allows us to express and move into the greater expression of the divine that we are. So Haley says this, I've decided to share something in the light of whatever, of recent events. I've never talked about it publicly, as it was one of the most traumatizing experiences of my childhood. After reconciling with my parents, I now know that they never intended for this horrible thing to happen to me. 13 years ago, I was locked inside a hospital examination room alone for what I think was 4 days. I can only assume it was 4 days because a faceless person slipped 16 blue plastic trays of food inside. I had nothing but a blue notebook and a pencil, and I was told I could have as many blue notebooks as I wanted. I was also told that I couldn't come out until I told the doctor who had molested me. You see, because these doctors believed that the only way I could be gay was if I had been molested. The trouble was, I had never been molested. So on the 4th day, in an act of self-preservation, I lied. And I said a relative who was already in prison molested me. One of my uncles was doing time, so it fit nicely in the narrative. Man. When they let me out of the room, I was told I wasn't gay and that I had been saved. I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior and read the Bible out loud during group therapy sessions. Another girl in my group had molested her young siblings. Jesus saved her too. and one boy shot up heroin. He was going through withdrawal with Jesus by his side. And I smiled and I cried and I praised the Lord in a theatrical way for saving me from my sins 2 more days before they let me out and my parents picked me up. That happened in Southern California in 2003. The program was covered by my parents' insurance company. I am the victim of conversion therapy, and I will not allow this to happen to the next generation, and I will not back down. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? I mean, even me, I consider myself pretty out there and pretty well read and kind of seen it all, experienced it all. But until I read Haley's story in November, I never knew that she went through that. And she's a teen that I've known for years. But my God, think about the courage it took for her to be that vulnerable to share that story. And I get the sense that it doesn't come from a victim standpoint. I feel her power. I feel her desire to just make sure that by sharing her story and what she went through, it would in some way educate people enough to say, you know, that's really probably not the greatest way to go about that, you know? Because that's how lifelong learning works. You move from, I don't know what I don't know, to I know what I don't know, to I know what I know. And so I believe in the compassion and the love of the human spirit and the human heart. I believe that as we continue to move from what we don't know, to what we know we don't know, to what we know, I believe as we move and progress through that in our lives, that love continues to show the way, that the highest and best continues to unfold, that maybe we stop and think, gee, where else in life and in our culture are we causing people to admit to things that never happened because that's the only way out of keeping them trapped and captivated? That's just one thing. Or maybe the mental experience and emotional abuse of having to put a child through something like that. Because she was a very young teenager at that age. And for it to be approved on their parents' insurance policy. Man. So, that's just one example of where one brave soul was courageous enough to be vulnerable to share her story because she knows full well that there is a better way, there is a different way to perceive life that is more loving and less harming. More loving, less harming. That's what we're all about. Because there's this thing called judgment that comes up that then tends to write our laws and write our rules. And we've talked about this before. What if we left judgment at the door? What if we left all judgment? This anonymous person wrote this about judgment. I truly battle with judgment in my life. Maybe you do too. I don't mean to be judged by others so much, as painful as that can be. I long ago realized there was nothing I could do more about it. And more often than not, the judgments were based on fake news. How many times have you found yourself judged and it was because that person judging you was judging you on something that wasn't even true? Maybe, maybe not. I mean, my own tendency, seemingly hardwired into my biology to judge others, usually I have found based on my own acceptance of fake news of one kind or another. But even if accurate, judging another is a human failing. So I often think of the quote below. Maybe it will help you as well. I'm going to read this quote, and I'm going to invite you to open up to this quote and just put yourself in that place. Imagine yourself there. And this was written by Andrew Bama. Now let us imagine you are there. You see Jesus hanging on the cross, and out of the corner of your eye, you notice his mother. She is one of the very small group of people weeping. How do you feel about her? Should she have spanked her son more? Should she have taught him more respect? Do you notice the absence of a father and believe that's why Jesus acted so rashly? Do you cast judgment about her parenting? Do you feel bad for her, but believe that her son should have made better decisions? Do you kind of see where this person's going with that? We never know the full story, folks. Never. But I do know that when we focus on ourselves, when we focus on going within and revealing that divinity that we are expressed as, and we don't really pay attention enough to pass judgment on what we see going on, but we don't see the whole picture, you know, that's taking our power back. When we can tell our own story with courage and vulnerability and not worry about judging anybody else's story or anybody else's life experience, that's powerful. That is so powerful. Let's go through to the next slide, please, real quickly. It is not meditation that stops the mind. It is the surrender of the mind to the soul and the soul to the truth. It is when you prefer the word of the truth to the word of your own intellect. Next slide, please. You must maintain a close communion with your true center. Your creative power is not an act of will. It is rather an act of your willingness to believe. Next slide, please. Nothing can harm you as much as your own thoughts unguarded. Next slide, please. Just going to run through these. Oh, here we go. Brené, you either walk inside your story and own it, or you stand outside of your story and hustle for your worthiness. You guys know what it feels like to hustle for your worthiness? It is a crappy feeling, isn't it? Really crappy. Or you can walk inside of your story and own it and take your power back and hold your head high and most likely bring a lot of peace and salvation to other people that may have gone through whatever it is that your story is about or is getting ready to go through it, but finding some kind of strength and meaning in the sharing of your own vulnerability and courage. Next slide, please. Here's our Rumiism for the day. For those that don't know, Rumi is our beautiful 10-year-old dog, Finnish Spitz. You suppose you are the trouble, but you are the cure. You suppose you are the lock on the door, but you are the key that opens it. Really take that in. Really take that in. You are the cure, and you hold the key that heals everything and unlocks everything within your life. Let's go to 13. So skip this next one because I've already said it. And go to the next one. Someday you will look back and know exactly why it had to happen. You guys know what I'm talking about? I'm seeing some heads nodding. So what's the important thing here? To maybe not judge what's happening right now? To maybe go to the higher? Next story, I'll tell you, because the last slide's what I'm talking about doing. But let's go to the next one after this. Your life is your story. Write well and edit often. Yeah, and then the last one, because this is what I was talking about. This brings it on home. When you walk on the path of spirituality, one thing is very essential. You must always see the hand of God in every action. Because there is no time where the hand of God is not in every action. And if we fail to see it, we are creating an illusion of separation that only continues to allow us to saw the limb off of the tree branch that we're sitting on. So I'm kind of bringing it all back together. Are you following me? All right. So what have we covered today? What have we learned today? A lot, actually. We've kind of covered a lot. But what do you think is the most important take homes? Trust and flow. Be in the moment. Be courageous. Be vulnerable. Don't turn away or discount any part of you because every part of you is the divine. The beautiful part about that is you get to write your story and edit it often. So if there are parts of you that you'd like to recalibrate, like the essence and energy of this full moon, then just edit your story. Evolve and grow to an even greater realization of the truth of who you are. And stay engaged. Stay engaged in your life. Don't live your life by proxy. Be active. Be active. So I will end with an affirmation. Or not. I can make up my own affirmation. The road to success is always under construction. We are constantly and consistently revealing the true expression of the divine nature of our being. There is no part of us that is not a part of God. I accept every aspect of my being. I move through and dissolve shame by being willing to be vulnerable and courageous. And I also create a world that works for everyone and make this world a better place by telling my story and editing it often. How's that?
So it is.
And so it is. Let's sing.